In this video, we'll discuss about impacted canines, both maxillary and mandibular. This is the content list. We have to discuss incidence, etiology, classification, indications, evaluation and localization, and management. Regarding incidence, you can see impacted canines in 2% of the population, more common in the females and more common in the maxilla when compared to the mandible. In maxilla, palatally placed are more common. In mandible, labially placed are more common, right? Then coming to the etiology, there are 5 points in the etiology. The first and foremost important thing is the lack of space in the arch. That means due to the tooth size, arch length discrepancy. When there is no place, it will obviously get impacted. The second thing is problems related to the primary canine. That means there may be failure of root resorption or over retention of the primary canine or early loss of the primary canine. All these factors will lead to the impacted canines. Then problems related to the permanent canines. That may be ankylosis or dilacerations of the root of the permanent canine or cistern neoplasm associated with the permanent canines. Then absence of maxillary lateral incisor. There is something theory called as guidance theory. That means the eruption of the maxillary impacted canines will follow the root of the maxillary lateral incisor. That is called as guidance theory. So when there is absence of the maxillary lateral incisor, that will obviously lead to the impacted canines. Then genetic. It may be due to the hereditary or some genetic conditions like alveolar cleft, like cleft lip and palate. In these cases, you can see the impacted canines. These are the etiological factors. Then coming to the classification. First, we'll see the maxillary impacted canine classification. The first class is nothing but the canines located palatally. Right? You have to draw these diagrams. This is the canine located palatally. And second class is nothing but the canine located labially. Right? The second number. Labially. And third classification is nothing but the tooth, impacted canine is located both on the palatal surface, on the labial surface. You can see in this diagram, this is the cut section of the maxilla. You can see the roots of the central incisor, lateral incisor and first premolar. So, the impacted canine is located both palatally and on the labial side. That means, it is located between the roots of the maxillary lateral incisor and first premolar. This is the third class. Fourth class is nothing but, it is also located in the labial side, but it is impacted in the alveolar process only. Right? You can see here, this is impacted in the alveolar process between the roots of the lateral incisor and first premolar. And again, it is located labial. That means both class 2 and class 4 are located labially. And class 5 is nothing but the impacted canines found in the edentulous maxilla. Right? You can see here, this is the edentulous maxilla. So, this is the impacted canines. This is regarding maxillary impacted canine classification. There are 5 class. Right? Then, in the mandible, it is generally commonly located in the labial side. But in the labial side, again, depending on the direction, it is, this blue colored one is nothing but the vertical, and this red colored one is nothing but the oblique direction, and this black colored one is nothing but the horizontal. That means impacted mandibular canines are divided into in the labial position and in the aberrant position. That means unusual positions. In the labial, we have the vertical, oblique and horizontal. In unusual positions, it may be located at the inferior border or it may be migrated to the opposite side. That means right side impacted canine is migrated to the left side. Right? This is regarding the classification. In maxillary canines also, in the palatally placed canine, you can see the difference. Difference in the position. That means it may be the vertical, oblique or horizontal. And labially also, it again, you can see labial or oblique or horizontal positions. Right? This is about classification. Now we'll discuss about the indications. Indications for removal of canines include malpositioning, improper positioning that could be labially or palatally. So, it will exert pressure on the adjacent teeth, especially on the maxillary lateral incisor, less commonly on the central incisor. So, there will be labioversion or lingoversion of the lateral incisor. So, that will lead to the changed position of adjacent teeth. That is one most important indication of removal, right? Malpositioning or changed position of adjacent teeth. Second one is lack of space in the arch. and patient is not willing to undergo orthodontic treatment. That means when there is gap, adjacent teeth will migrate and close that gap, leading to the arch length loss or space loss. So if patient is willing, we can create or we can regain that space by orthodontic treatment, and we can guide that impacted tooth into that place. But patient is not willing for orthodontic treatment and there is lack of space, then you should go for extraction of the canine. And third is internal or external resorption. Internal or external resorption of the impacted canine or adjacent tooth. It could be the lateral incisor or first premolar, or impacted canine itself may undergo internal or external resorption. In those cases, you have to go for removal. Then cyst, especially dentigerous cyst or neoplasm formation around the impacted canine. And presence of edentulous jaws. That means canine presented in edentulous jaws. In those cases, if the covering bone is more, then you can leave it. But the covering bone is less than 2 mm, then pressure from the dentures will obviously lead to resorption of that bone, and it may stimulate the eruption process. That means that canine may begin to erupt. In those cases, you have to go for removal. Then referred pain, especially neurological symptoms in some patients, if there is impacted canine, patient may feel pain. It may refer pain. So in those cases also you have to go for removal. And cleft palate. After cleft palate surgery, especially in the maxilla, right? In the maxilla may become narrow, or may there may be the surgical scar. These will prevent the eruption of the canine. Right? In those cases you have to go for extraction. Otherwise, if there is proper positioning of the canine, then you can go for secondary bone grafting, SABG, secondary alveolar bone grafting, and you can guide the eruption of the canine. After that, extreme dilaceration of the root. That means you can see in this case there is extreme dilaceration of the root of the canine. In those cases also you should go for extraction. You can't do anything with that. And extreme impaction or ankylosis. Impacted canine is ankylosed, or if there is extreme impaction, that means it is impacted in between the roots of the lateral incisor and central incisor, or in between the roots of the first premolar and second premolar. In those cases also you should go for removal, right? So these are the indications of removal, right? Then we'll discuss about evaluation, how you should plan the treatment options for impacted canines. There are some clinical signs, clinically what you can see when there is impacted canine. The first one is, if there is delayed eruption of the canine, normal eruption timing of the canine, it could be maxillary or mandible, is 11 to 13 years, right? So if there is delayed eruption or prolonged retention of the primary canine, that means if the primary canine is retained beyond the 14 to 15 years, then you can suspect there is impacted canine. Otherwise, the absence of normal labial bulge. You can see in the normal individual, there is labial bulge by 12 years. 12 years, you can see the bulge of the canine, right? If there is absence of the labial bulge or the bulge is present on the palatal side, then in those cases, you may suspect the impacted canine. These are the clinical signs which indicate there is the possibility of impacted canine. And radiographically, you should determine when there is impacted canine, you should determine its mesiodistal position and superior inferior position and buccolingual position also. Mesiodistal and superior inferior position you can determine by IOPA or OPG. For buccolingual position, you should take occlusion or CBCT. Right? And you can use tube shift or Clark's slab rule also. You know that same side lingual and opposite buccal. And you can use buccal object rule. These two are not same, right? So tube shift technique is nothing but you will maintain same vertical angulation, but you will change horizontal angulation, right? When you first will take one IOPA, after that you will change horizontal angulation and will take another IOPA. So when you compare both the IOPAs, If the object of interest that is impacted canine moves same side with the your tube, that is radiation site, right? That will be located on the lingual side. If it moves in the opposite direction, then it is located on the buccal side, right? This is the tube, right? For second IOPA, you will change here. So object moves in this direction, then it is called as, it is said to be located on the lingual side. If it moves in the opposite direction, then it is said to be lying on the buccal side, right? The buccal object rule is, concept is same, but the horizontal angulation is same, you will change the vertical angulation. That is more important. Vertical angulation is changed by 20 degrees. So, when you change the vertical angulation and when you compare the two IOPAs, if it moves in the same direction, then it is said to be lying on the lingual side. If it moves opposite side, then it is said to be on the buccal side. Right? So, you can use these techniques for localization. That is for localization of the canine. Localization or position of the canine is very much important, because based on that localization only, which type of flap you should use and where you should remove the bone, for complete planning of the surgery, you need exact localization of the canine. Right? So now we'll discuss about management options. There are 5 treatment options. First one is no treatment except monitoring. This is indicated when the canine position is in good place and no pathology. That means no external resorption or internal resorption, or no cystar neoplasm formation, or if it is severely displaced and difficult to remove or expose in those cases. That means if it is in remote place or if the patient is not willing. These are the conditions where we do nothing except monitoring, right? Regular follow. The second option is interceptive removal of primary canine. That means if the patient is in the age of 10 to 13 years, and if there is no labial bulge, in those cases, you will wantedly remove the primary canine to allow the eruption of the permanent canine. Right? That is the second option. And third option is surgical removal. We have seen the indications for surgical removal. In those cases, we will go for surgical removal. The fourth is surgical exposure with orthodontic alignment. Right? So, in this case, these third and fourth options are the commonly done. In this case, there are 3 techniques. The first one is gingivectomy, that is excisional approach. And second one is apically positioned flap. And third one is closed approach. Right? There are some indications which technique is to be used. The first one is canine tip or canine crown. If it is coronal to the mucogingival junction. In these diagrams, you can see this red line is nothing but the mucogingival junction. So, canine crown, impacted canine crown is coronal to the mucogingival junction, and if there is adequate presence of keratinized gingiva, that means attached gingiva. In this case, you will go for simple exposure by gingivectomy. That means, we'll take cruciform incision. That means X-shaped incision in the estimated position of the canine, like this. This is the cruciform incision. So with this incision, we will develop 4 triangular flaps. That means we have to elevate 4 triangular flaps. After that, after exact position of the canine is determined, then we can excise these 4 triangular flaps so that crown is recovered or crown is exposed. So, in this case, as it is closer to the occlusal plane, there will be natural eruption. There is no need of orthodontic alignment. That means with the help of brackets or ligature voids or elastic chains, there is no need to tie on this crown. Right? This is the first one. And second one is apically positioned flap. This is indicated when the crown of the canine is apical to the mucogingival junction. You can see here, crown is located apical to the mucogingival junction and there is inadequate keratinized gingiva, that is attached gingiva also insufficient. In this case, we'll take apically positioned flap like this, right, with the releasing incisions, and after elevating the flap, we'll shift this flap to the apically to the crown of the impacted canine, so that crown is visible, and we'll suture the flap here. It is same as the perio-apically positioned flap in periodontics, right? So these are the conditions for apically positioned flap. And third one is closed approach. Closed approach is indicated when the canine is located remote. That means it is somewhat more higher from the occlusal plane. Or if it is located palatally, in these cases we will go for closed approach. Closed approach is nothing but we will take crevicular incisions like this and will elevate complete flap. In this case, the orthodontic aid for eruption is must. That means we will attach the elastic chain or ligature wire onto the crown of this impacted canine, right? After that, we'll close the flap. This is the third approach, closed approach. And the fifth option is nothing but the auto transplantation of the canine. That means first we have to go for surgical removal without damaging the impacted canine. And after that, we have to prepare the socket. And in that socket, we'll transplant that surgically removed impacted canine. This is another option, but not frequently done. You have to concentrate on the surgical removal and the surgical exposure with orthodontic alignment. This orthodontic alignment is indicated when the crown position or inclination of the impacted canine is in good place and it is to be derived into the desired position, right? So these are the options available. Now we'll discuss about surgical removal. You can do it under local anesthesia or general anesthesia. When you are going for local anesthesia, for maxillary impacted canines, mostly you will need anterior superior alveolar nerve block or infraorbital nerve block. In some cases, you may need MSA also, right? When the maxillary canine is located on the palatal side, then in that case, you have to block the nasopalatine nerve block along with the greater palatine nerve block on that side, right? So for mandibular canines, mostly you will need the same side inferior alveolar nerve block along with the lingual nerve block. But one special case is when the impacted canine is migrated to the opposite side. For example, if the right mandibular canine is migrated to the left mandibular side, because it maintains its original nerve supply, in that case, you have to go for bilateral inferior alveolar nerve block along with one lingual nerve block, right? That is the special case because it maintains its original nerve innervation, that is on the right side. And again, you are doing the procedure on the left side. That means you have to go for both side, right? So after anesthesia, you have to go for incision. Incision is different for maxillary canines and mandibular canines also. In the maxillary canine also, is it located on the buccal side or on the palatal side? For example, first the incision design for maxillary canine which is located on the buccal vestibule. In that case also there are two varieties. Is it located low in the buccal side, buccal vestibule, or high in the buccal vestibule, right? So in this case you can see here, this is the mandibular canine which is located in the buccal vestibule, but it is almost closer to the alveolar process. That means it is low in the buccal vestibule. In this case, you have to go for crevicular incisions along with the releasing incisions, right? So, in this case, I will go for, this is the first premolar and this is the second premolar. So, I will go for the crevicular incisions, that is gingival sulcus incisions like this. This is the crevicular incision. And you have to incorporate the releasing incisions. This is anterior releasing incision and this is posterior releasing incisions along with the crevicular incisions, right? So this is the incision designed for maxillary canine, which is located low in the buccal vestibule. Now we'll see which is located high in the buccal vestibule. In this case, there is no need to go for crevicular incisions. You can take a semilunar incisions like this. You can take semilunar incision in the buccal vestibule. You have to maintain the attached gingiva. Then you can take the semilunar incision in the buccal vestibule like this, and you can elevate the flap. Right? And this is the incision design. When the maxillary canine is located on the palatal side, right? So, say if it is located on the right side of the palate, in this case, this is the maxillary canine crown, right? So, in this case, you have to go for the, again, crevicular incisions on the palatal side, on the palatal side of the teeth, right? So, in this case, mostly, if you want to expose the palatal canine, then you need same side, second premolar, right? Second premolar crevicular incisions to opposite side till lateral incisor, right? On the palatal side, crevicular incisions like this. There is no need of releasing incisions. Only you have to develop the enveloped flap. When you want to go for removal of the bilateral impacted canines on the palatal side, then this releasing crevicular incision should be extended till the opposite side second premolar, right? That is from second premolar to opposite side second premolar when you are going for removal of the bilateral impacted maxillary canines located on the palatal side, right? After that, you have to elevate the flap. This is the incision design for maxillary canines. Now we'll see the incision design for mandibular canine, right? So it is very much simple. For mandibular canine exposure, you have to take the horizontal incision in the labial vestibule along with the some releasing incisions, right? So this diagram already have elevated the flap, but this red color line denotes your incision length. Right? This is regarding the incision. After that, you have to elevate the flap. Full thickness, mucoperiosteal flap should be elevated. Right? So, in this case, you will elevate along with the interdental papillas. In this case, there is no need to elevate the interdental papillas. Right? On the palatal side also, when you are elevating the flap, you have to take care not to injure the nasopalatine nerves and vessels. Right? So, you can preserve them. If it is difficult to preserve them, then you can cauterize them, or you can ligate them and then dissect them, right? So in this case, I have preserved this black colored one is nothing but the inferior alveolar nerves vessels, right? And this is the flap elevated, full thickness mucoperiosteal flap elevated, and this is the bone exposed, right? So after bone exposure, after flap elevation, you have to identify the bulge. This is the very much important point, because due to the impacted canine, you can easily identify a bulge, a prominence that is produced by the impacted canine crown. You have to identify that, because that is the area where you have to going for bone removal, right? That is the most important step, identification of the bulge. After that, you have to prepare a window and exposure of the crown. After identifying the bulge, you have to take micromotor, right, with a rotating burr, and you have to remove the bone in that bulge area, and you have to expose the complete impacted canine crown. At least greatest diameter of the mesiodistal diameter of the crown should be exposed, right? So in this case, you can see here, this is the impacted canine. So you have to go for bone removal in and around the canine. So I will go for bone removal around the crown like this, and onto the crown also you have to go for bone removal. That is called as window preparation. After window preparation, you have to try to luxate the crown. Right? You can take straight elevators or pedestal elevator with any, you have to luxate, try to luxate the crown. Right? If you succeeded, that means there is luxation of the tooth and there is dislodgement of the tooth. In some cases, you can go for the crown retrieval with the forceps also. Right? Forceps also, you can remove the crown. Or if it is simply luxated, then you can easily go for removal of the entire tooth. This condition is possible when there is no root curvature. Generally, for canines, especially maxillary canines, there will be curvature in the apical third of the root. If there is no curvature, or if it is, there is favorable root curvature, in that case, you can go for easily removal of the crown. Crown along with the root. If there is no luxation, right? There is no luxation, then you have to go for bone removal over the root. Bone removal over the root, and you have to section between the crown and root, right? So, in this case, you can see here, this is the canine. There is root curvature in the apical third. So, you can't directly remove the tooth in toto. So, I will go for bone removal in and around the root, and I will section between the crown and root like this, right? So, I have separated crown from the root. After separating like this, after sectioning, you have to remove the crown. After removing the crown, you have to prepare a purchase point in the root, right? So, in this case, I will prepare a purchase point. This is the purchase point. This red colored one is nothing but the purchase point. From that purchase point, I will use triers and try to dislodge the root surface, right? So, you have to prepare the purchase point. After preparing purchase point, you can go for the root removal. After that, you have to suture, right? So, this is regarding incisions and crown exposure, bone removal. This is for the mandibular canines, right? Mostly mandibular canines are horizontal in position, right? So, with this incision, you have to elevate. This is the lower lip, right? And this is the mandibular arch. And this is the retractor. This is the retractor retracting the flap, right? So, this is the flap which is developed. And this is the crown exposure. Right? So, you have to draw these diagrams. Suturing, you can simply go for interdental suturing in this case, right? And in this case, you can simple interrupted sutures you can place. In this case also, you can suture interdentally, right? And in this case, you can go for simple interrupted sutures. Some special cases, especially in cases of maxillary palatally impacted canines, you need to remove the tooth in three pieces, right? That means, first you have to section the crown and you have to remove the crown. After that, again, you have to remove the bone on the root surface and the root surface should be sectioned and you have to remove it separately, right? That means, if you remove the center one first, that is the first part. After that is the second part and this is the third part, right? So, you may need to section like this also. And another special case is when the tooth is positioned horizontally, especially in the maxillary arch. That means if you take this is the maxillary alveolar process and this is the root of the maxillary lateral incisor and this is the root of the maxillary first premolar. So your teeth is positioned horizontally. That means the crown is positioned on the palatal side. And root is positioned in between the roots of the adjacent teeth. That is maxillary lateral incisor and maxillary first premolar. In this case, you may need to elevate flap on both sides. That is on the palatal side and on the buccal side also. First you have to elevate on the palatal side as I shown here. And after that you have to section the crown. And you have to remove this crown part. And after that you have to open the flap on the buccal side. That is by opening like this. Gingival crevicular incisions and from buccal side you have to prepare a window and you have to section the apical third of the root surface, right? That means this piece is removed. After that you have to apply pressure on the cut surface of the root so that this interdental root portion is delivered on the parietal side. This is one more special case, right? And again, when you are removing, you have to take precaution not to injure or not to luxate adjacent teeth. That is one important thing. You have to study the root anatomy and position of the tooth preoperatively. You have to take CBCT like that. If there is any chances of injury to the adjacent tooth or luxation of the adjacent tooth, in that case you have to inform the patient previously. There are chances of like this. There may be the chances of luxation or there may be the chances of removal of adjacent tooth. You have to inform like that. Mainly there are two complications. The first one is luxation of the adjacent tooth. So you should not use adjacent tooth root as your fulcrum. That is the main important thing. And the second thing is there may be chances of perforation into the maxillary sinus lining or into the nasal cavity. If it happens also, it doesn't matter if there is no infection. You have to provide the soft tissue closure. That's all. This is all about impacted canines. If you like this video, hit the like button, share the video, subscribe the channel.